Welcome, everybody, to Raised in Wisco. I'm your host, Joel Clapish, alongside my co-host, Danielle Fairman. In the doldrums of spring right now, driving down the highway, and what do I see? Man, I don't know if they're working hard at it or hardly working at it anymore. Those toms are in the field and they're fanned out. But, you know, at the beginning of the season, they're all working at the same time. You'll see or four toms fanned out at the same time. Mm-hmm. Now, it's like if there's two of them next to each other or three, two of them are just eaten. And one's fanned out. It's like they're not paying attention as much anymore. And do you notice that this as is the why season I asked, drags on?
Yeah, this is why I asked all the questions I did last time about what decoys to use. Because right now is when I start feeling like they do not give a butt. A butt. They don't give a butt.
Yeah, it seems like that a lot of the turkeys right now are kind of, I mean, the hens are on nests a lot. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Everybody has a different opinion as to when the sweet spot is. I feel like seasons like 4 and 5 can be a sweet spot if you're patient.
Really? Oh.
Because when those hens go back into the woods and sit on their nests,
that's
when those toms who are not the dominant toms and haven't gotten, you know, haven't done any breeding yet, they're the ones out there in the field at that stage
the
of the
ugly
game and looking.
The toms.
Well, I'm not saying they're ugly. They're just brothers. They're not the cool guys at the bar. You know what I mean? They're just
we have
not
to
the
wait
cool
till
guys.
They're pretty much they're, done and over with.
Their
and
fan
then...
dance is not as attractive as the earlier dominant toms. But I think they get pushed around a lot. And I think by now the dominant toms start getting tired.
Oh, yeah.
And I want to be clear about this. Don't think that because a tom is dominant, he's the biggest one or has the biggest spurs or biggest beard. That is mm-hmm. not the case. The sub-dominant toms often have bigger spurs and beards and way more because they haven't been using all their energy spitting and drumming out there.
Have you got a double beard?
I got a four-bearded turkey.
I'm sorry,
one
what? A four-beard?
Four beards. There were four because they judge it based on the wax. So that's what they call the point at which the beard grows out of the chest of the turkey. Mm-hmm. It's called the wax. And if there are four different waxes, and at the time, the turkey that I killed, and I killed it up in Ashapan, right about 20 minutes north of where I live, it was the 35th highest scoring turkey on the Safari Club International record books at the time.
Nice.
I'm sure it's been surpassed, but that was kind of a newer scoring system too, so it's not they don't have Boone and Crockett or Pope and Young for turkeys. I do have an interesting turkey hunt coming up though. I have a season 5 tag, mm-hmm. and I'm going to hunt with a bow.
I'm sorry, say that again. Everybody needs
to
listen to this.
Turkey with a bow. And
what happened when I wanted to go bow hunting for a turkey?
You did go bow hunting.
Yeah, but
for
what
a turkey.
Did you say?
I said shotguns are for killing turkeys, not bows. But and I stick to that. But here's the problem. So. When I was in the legislature, I wrote a bill that allowed archery hunting in all municipalities. So no town, no village, no city may outlaw bow hunting, period. And there were a lot of municipalities who were not happy about that. But those are the same municipalities where deer populations are out of control and running into cars all the time. So we passed it, and now you can Thank bow you. Hunt in every municipality, but they still have jurisdiction over firearms in a lot of those municipalities. And so I have no choice but to hunt with a bow. And a buddy of mine's got some toms that kind of go through his yard. And he's got 2.5 acres. But they've got so many turkeys around River Hills, they're running, walking in front of cars and chasing kids and poking
chasing
at windows.
Chasing kids?
Sure. Haven't you ever seen a turkey chase somebody?
I have not seen a turkey chase somebody. I have not had that privilege
and
of seeing
spurs,
that.
And those spurs, I picked up a turkey I shot with my grandfather's gun a couple weeks ago. And that sucker, I mean, it got me. It got me really good. Look at that scar
what?
On my finger. Yeah, those suckers are sharp, man. Huh. They're nasty. Hey, I don't want to go too long before we get Mike Keller involved in the conversation.
Hello, Mike Keller.
Mike Keller Hello. Is here, and Mike Keller is one of those kind of outdoors people extraordinaires. He always, every time I see him, he looks like he could lean against a lamp pole and fall asleep. I'm serious. He's always well tanned, and he's always looks like he's got about 2 hours of sleep in him in the last 48 hours. But Mike Keller is one of the first people I ever hunted goose with in my life. But this is a guy who diversifies, and he's kind of he's very much about the dogs. We've hunted with his dog Peaches, who's in studio today, who's now 11. Since Peaches was a puppy, and this is one of the best retrieving dogs that I have ever seen in my life.
Yes.
I mean, I swear, we were out one time, and Peach had a 3/4 mile retrieve that she couldn't see.
I remember doing
over a hill,
a hunt before you realized.
Get closer to the mic, Mike.
Mike. I remember one of our first hunts that you realized that I'm not this person you thought I was prior. That he was on top of a hill, and Peaches ran down into like some corn that wasn't completely chopped down, and he's just having hand signals just from super far away. I'm like, how in the world? But that was like one of our first hunts together that you realized that I'm not just this.
Pretty face Dicks. With a pair of camo pants.
Yeah. But I'm, like that I'm, that was like a great hunt.
This is family radio, so we're not going to try to I don't even want to know what you guys are talking about. You were or weren't, or he thought you was.
You were there
wasn't.
Too. You invited me on the hunt.
Yeah, we hunted together. We had some killer hunts.
When I had a staunch policy of not hunting with huntresses.
You know, we've actually had, we've done radio shows and podcasts on the whole huntress and women in hunting and the you know, the difficulties of making sure everything is, the opportunities are equal across the board. And speaking of huntresses, my daughter Violet is here.
Yes.
She's not in studio with us. She's actually being a good girl and doing her homework out there. That's my, I don't know if I told, did I tell you, Danielle? Violet is now the student body president of Kettle Moraine.
Yes, I said hello, Miss President.
Yeah, so I'm so jacked that my family is getting out of politics. But, hey, before we move on, got to say hello to my Oconomowoc family, the Kennedy clan, our 5 loyal listeners every week. I hope they're doing well. Aiden, get ready. You got a tag coming up, buddy. You and I are going to hit the woods and hopefully get you your first tom. Mm-hmm. But that reminds me.
Yes.
Aiden's fan of his first turkey is almost dried and ready. Ready to plaque up, Aiden. So if you're listening, I'm going to be working on that soon. You know, Aiden's mom is my boss.
Is your boss?
Aiden's mom's Robin Kennedy. Yeah. So
I like Robin. Hello,
so Robin. So, Robin, if you want your son to have the joy of hunting and get this on the wall, you gotta ease off on me a little bit. She's very hard on me.
I believe it.
No, I'm playing. She's awesome. She's an awesome boss.
And speaking of Robin, so I ordered something on Amazon.
Okay.
It reminded me of last week, so it reminded me of Robin.
Okay.
I bought patchouli laundry detergent.
That sounds horrible. Oh my gosh! You know,
but I went to
smells
a buddy,
just like '90s.
I went to
stand patchouli.
I
Do
went
you like
to
the smell patchouli.
No, it's what all the
it's all grunge hippies.
Girls
you know what
and
that is too?
Wore back in the '90s.
Wait,
was
I
like,
would say, do I smell good? But I came straight from work, so you can't smell me. But
well, that's what you think. That's what you think. Anastasia, we need a fan in here.
I have a fan in here that I'm keeping
because
of the patchouli and the construction woman.
Yeah, no kidding. Nothing goes worse together than construction and patchouli.
And patchouli.
And that's the funniest thing. Like, Robin's like one of the most awesome people I've ever met, but she wears patchouli and likes Pink Floyd. Those are two things that just... I mean, I guess patchouli and Pink Floyd probably go together, though, don't they, a little bit?
I don't know. I cannot tell you... one Pink Floyd song right off the top of my head.
Another brick in the wall.
I know the... Oh, look, a dog. I remember, like, the triangle
and
rainbow.
You're so easily distracted, Danielle. Danielle, I think you have the instincts of a canine. Squirrel. Squirrel. Food. Bone. Doorbell.
Friend,
Keller, why are you so quiet today?
Because you're talking.
That's
so
true.
So I'm just listening.
I do talk a lot. Hi, Violet. Violet, do you want to come and say hi to the listeners? Come on in here for a second.
Violet!
So my daughter, Violet, I'm so proud of her. She's a student body president. Hey, do you want to say hi to Robin Kennedy and the Kennedy clan?
Hey, Robin!
Guess what? Hey, tell Robin what we're... Well, Robin knows what we're working on. Tell these guys what we're working on with Greg Kazmierski over at Buck Rub.
Yes, so I got the pleasure of organizing the A-Team Adventure Series. And what we do with the A-Team Adventure Series is we take... some of the awesome people from the A-Team. And we go out and we appreciate the natural resources of Wisconsin. And right now, we are hooking up with Buck Rub, and we're going to do some archery. And that's in the process June 21st, 24th.
You planned it.
I know. This is June horrible, 24th. Dad. I'm on the spot. I'm sorry.
It's all right. We're taking folks out. We're taking some folks, and we're going to have Diverse Abilities Archery. So I think that's pretty sweet.
Yeah. Pretty sweet. That's going to be fun.
Yeah, it'll be good. Okay, you can go back and do your homework now.
Okay.
Keller, what?
Very proud.
Mike Keller is one of these guys who he's kind of like who I would be if I didn't have to worry about who I was. Does that make sense?
It does not make sense.
I think that makes sense. I think if I didn't have to worry under any circumstances what people's perception of me was.
Yeah,
or,
I feel like you have to worry a lot about that.
Yeah,
I worry about that.
You
Everybody
do?
Does to a certain extent.
A little.
I stopped.
You stopped worrying about it? I think that's clear, Danielle.
Oh, thank you.
I think I worry, I worry more now about whether people think I'm a nice person or not.
Oh.
That's what I care to really think about.
Do you really worry about that?
I hope that they think I'm a nice person at the end of the day.
Okay, so I'm just going to give the audience just kind of a sense as to it, but you got to promise you can't get your feelings hurt by this. Mike is a Marine. Okay, yes. That is going to tell you 90% of what you need to know about his personality when you're in a field setting up for geese or setting up. He is militaristic to a certain extent, and I never knew that perception of people or perception by people bothered you, because you are a very directed person. You know the way you want to see something unfold, and you're not afraid to tell people that. I think that characteristic has also led to a lot of your successes.
I think that I've learned to communicate that better now, though. I used to be like, D.I., ha, 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 do this, why can't you do this?
And now then I'm just like, people thought you were an a-hole or what?
Right. Now I'm like, hey, man, this is what we're going to do today. This is how we're going to do it. And if you got any questions, ask. And then if they don't have any questions and they don't ask, then I'm like, what do you mean? I thought you were going to ask. No,
all right,
kidding.
Hold that thought. When we come back, we're going to talk to Mike Keller about his duck hunting on the big water, his fishing adventures, and a giveaway he's got coming up.
Woo!
You're listening to Raised in Wisco. We'll be right back.
The song Peach is named after.
And you know what? Peaches is in the studio.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Going to the country, you're going to eat a lot of peaches.
Why does everybody know this song? I'm the only one that does not.
I don't know.
This is a famous song.
It's like a very famous song.
Is this peaches for you, peaches for me?
No.
Peaches for free?
Peaches come from a can.
Nope. No clue. This is the one that Melissa was talking about. And the reason why I say Melissa is because we, me and a couple people went out with him, Fowl Dawgs. On Peach's Pride, the name of the boat, limited out, 5-person limit. But they were playing that song, and I'm like, I have no clue what song you're talking about.
And she knows the song.
No
like,
song.
When we
no
play
clue.
It, she sits right up. She knows
That's
it's her
funny.
Song.
Aww.
Mike Keller's in the studio. Mike Keller, we went into break. We were talking about how I'm going to introduce it. A lot of people would love to say I make a living in the outdoors. A lot of people. Myself,
they would.
I'm on that list. Danielle, you're probably on that list.
I would love to.
When a large percentage of people who say I want to be, you know, I want to get paid and live my life doing things in the outdoors, I think a lot of people underestimate the amount of work it takes to do that. It is not an easy thing. Like, you know, you'll see Chad Belding on The Fowl Life, and you think, man, that's awesome. All he does is hunts all the time, gets paid all this money. It is so hard. And nobody works harder. And I've never met anyone who works harder in my life than Chad Belding. I mean, or you know, Shockey, or any one of the greats.
Klein.
Brian Klein.
333 sunrises or something crazy last year.
It's insane how hard people work who want to make a life and a living in the outdoors, because none of the outdoor money comes easy. Even if you're a top dog at a TV show, you're busting your hump to get sponsors all the time, make those sponsors happy.
What I think a lot of people don't think about is the day that they decide they're sleeping in today because it's raining or it's windy or it's cold.
Or they get called off from the construction site.
Right. Or got a hangover or whatever it is. It's like you're out there. And it's like, and I think there's a lot of difference between guys that are out there with you and guys that aren't. Like, I kind of claim my fame of, like, I'm embracing the suck with you. You know, it's terrible out here. You're right, but we're in this together, and it's going to be
fun. We're doing it together.
I cannot tell you how many times I go just about bonkers in my head when that alarm goes off at 3 a.m. Yeah. When that alarm goes off at 3 a.m., you do not feel good about things. And I mean, I'm a night hawk.
Right.
Fortunately for me, drinking's never part of the equation, so I never have to worry about that. But when I go to bed at midnight because I needed to see the last 15 minutes of Better Call Saul, and then I go to sleep and I wake up at 3 a.m. I do not want to get out of bed, but I'll tell you one thing. I have never regretted one time with the woods being awake when the woods is waking up.
Oh, that's perfect.
Or the sun rises, sun's coming up over the water. Mm-hmm. Never once. So I was going to give Mike a compliment and say, you are somebody who has made a living. You have said, screw traditional work.
I'm trying.
I am going to make my life busting my ass on the water in the woods.
And it's still better.
And you have changed the dynamic of your life. You've had some ups and downs. You've changed the dynamic of your life, and you've changed it to, you are malleable in as much as, yes, you are very militaristic in your approach sometimes, but you're very malleable because you used to be a field hunter for geese and ducks hard. We did it a lot, quite a bit.
Yep.
And then you learned a new process, started layout boat hunting yourself, and then you started turning that into a career. And now you've got one of the more successful salmon fishing, salmon trout fishing operations in Lake Michigan. How do you
get there?
How do you fundamentally change something you do and then become an expert in something else? And I ask that not hypothetically, because this is kind of something I've done in my life, everything from the legislature to working with disabled folks to owning an alligator and wild hog hunting outfitter. But there are very few people in the category of being able to change, learn, grow each time.
I think for me, it's my gosh. A little bit of OCD, maybe. I'm a little obsessive about things. Like, I'll get bored. Honestly, going out and doing the same thing every single day.
That's more ADHD, I think.
Yeah, that too. But, like, when I learn something new, I immerse myself in it.
Yeah.
It's not like some people are like, oh, I'm going to teach you how to do this. I started to fish with Brian Klein, and he taught me how to set out planer boards, and it was on from there.
Is a planer board an outrigger?
Kind of, but not really. An outrigger is a little different system, but does the same thing. Shoots the lines to the side so you can run more than one line on each side of the boat.
So in essence, take me through how that works. When you get to the marina in the morning and you're setting your boat up, what are you hoping to accomplish? What are you running? What can people expect if they're going to go out with you?
I think
I know what a planer board is, but what's an outrigger? Because it's those
big
things that
boom
drop down.
That drops down and
it is those?
Shoots out. Yeah, okay. Out rigs.
Yep. Okay.
It rigs them out.
Yeah.
Really?
The good news is right now I've been sleeping at the marina on the boat, which is pretty awesome.
Yeah.
So the commute to work is really nice.
None.
It's that extra 40 minutes, like literally every
day. I want to come and do that with you sometime. I want to sleep overnight on the lake.
Come and do it. I even got a little extra bedroom for you.
You have two bedrooms on your boat?
Yep. And there's a bedroom-ish. That's
I don't need
got the big bed. And then there's a side
We got the couch now
bedroom,
too. You can sleep on the couch.
That has a bunk bed in it. One of them's a shelf.
All right, and we got to go to break already. When we come back, we're going to talk about your giveaway. You got a giveaway coming up. And I want you to actually talk about some of the adventures on the water, some of the adventures fishing. And then I really want to talk in one of the segments about your duck hunting out there. That is fascinating to me. As you know, I'll admit it, I'm a little afraid of it. I'm a little afraid to go
into the layout boat hunting.
Yeah. I'm a little scared. It can get dicey out there. I mean, we're talking about Lake Michigan.
And you're in waders, too. It's terrifying.
It can get... See, you're not helping.
See, but you shouldn't be in waders.
You
Whoever said
be
you're
in
wearing what waders else? In a layout boat.
I don't.
Okay.
I don't want.
We're talking waders, layout boats,
in the
ducks.
Boat. Yeah, you want waders on that.
Fishing boat. Lake Michigan. When we come back with Captain Mike Keller, Danielle Fairman, and for the three of us, I'm Joel Clayfish. You're listening to Raised in Wisco.
Yes. I've been singing this all day. All day.
Man, I do have to give it up for Queen. They were awesome. Almost as good as Michael Jackson.
I feel like
as good as the Boogeyman.
Yeah, I don't know.
Welcome back to Raised in Wisco. You co-host Danielle Fairman alongside our host, the one and only Joel Clayfish.
Yeah.
Followed by Peaches.
Right? Peaches
is the important
studio.
Part of this couple.
Captain. When did you
Captain Peaches.
Captain Mike Keller. Mike, how long were you in the Marines?
I was in the Marine Corps for 4 years, just shy.
So
days.
E3 or E4 when you
That's
left?
I was in E4 when I got out.
That's pretty fast advancement, young man. That's sergeant.
Hey, they gave rank away when I was in.
Did they?
No, I was corporal. If I would have stayed in for 6 more months, right. I would have been
You'd
a sergeant.
Been sergeant.
Wow.
So you had the two stripes on your chevron,
mm-hmm.
right? Is that what corporal?
Yep.
You know what? The biggest thing, I do this. I'm going to tell you something. The best way to not get a ticket when you're pulled over. I know this isn't really like Raised in Wisco outdoor stuff, but maybe Charlie Barron's can borrow this.
Oh,
the best way to get out of a ticket is to know the jurisdiction and the rank of the police officer who's coming to your door.
Oh.
So if they have, and some, I mean, it's paramilitary, right? I mean, they've got sergeants, lieutenants, captains, and some police forces have corporals. So when they come to your door, the first thing to know is whether they're a municipal police officer or a county sheriff's deputy. That's the first thing to know, because for whatever reason, police officers don't like to be called deputy, and deputies don't like to be called police officers.
Can't we just call them officer? Sorry,
you
officer.
You can't. I mean, to
Hello,
be fair,
officer.
That is polite. They are all officers. They're all peace officers, not police officers. Under the definition of the statute, they're called peace officers. So they all are all officers. But if you know, if somebody comes to your door in a brown uniform,
yep.
most likely
Isn't
they're a
sheriff?
County sheriff's deputy.
Yeah.
And if you call them deputy, they say to themselves, oh, this person knows a little bit about, you know, police rank and a little bit about jurisdiction and that kind of thing. So yes, deputy, no deputy. If they come and they've got chevrons on their shoulder, if they have three of them and you say yes, sergeant, no sergeant, because sergeants will patrol quite a bit. I've been pulled over by sergeants before.
You've been pulled over?
I have. And I'm telling you, if you know their rank whether they're a city municipal PD or if they're a county sheriff's deputy, I really do think it does matter. I had one stretch there. I was pulled over 11 times for
what?
Speeding, and I did not, knock on wood, get a
That's
ticket.
More times than I've ever been pulled
I was
over
pulled
in my
o-
life.
It, yeah, well.
I think I've been given a ticket every time I've been pulled over. Every single time.
So I had an
They're
encounter
like,
with.
This guy wins.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what to tell you about that, Mike.
I had an encounter with two sheriffs last week, and I was in the back of a cop car.
What? Oh, yeah.
When you know this story. I
saved the goslings crossing the road.
The three goslings and the two geese. We shut down the whole on ramp. It was
Mike
great.
Mike Keller, you have. You started, I mean, you've been hunting for quite a while.
Yeah.
And how did you make the transition from field hunting geese and ducks to not just water hunting? Okay, because you're not the guy who drives out and hunts puddle ducks in your boat and
I did that when
up
I grew
camo.
Up. I grew up hunting the marsh in Canada out of a canoe.
In Canada?
In Canada.
You're from Canada?
No. My dad would take me there for 10 days every year. as a kid and cut me and my cousin loose in the marsh.
Uh-huh.
And we'd go out and figure it out.
Nice.
When we got old enough.
Were you, were you running decoys or like spinners at that point?
Spinners were illegal at that. Okay. They weren't even created. And then when they made them, holy cow.
Yeah.
It was when they first hit the market with a spinner, it wasn't fair.
I bet it
wasn't. It wasn't fair.
Like now,
you take one weird-looking robo duck that had giant wings, weighed like 800 pounds. It didn't even look like a duck. And you'd turn that on, and not kidding, they'd come from the stratosphere. Locked.
How cool.
They'd be like, oh my God, look, we got to go check that out.
And, now they're leery.
Now they're everywhere. Now.
It depends everywhere on where you use them. If you use them in a field and you got 10 of them and the mallards are doing it, it's great.
Yeah, no, I think the mallards will still respond.
If you're using them in a marsh, it's not really a natural look, I don't think. If you go places where they timber hunt, they hide them and they turn them on intermittent.
Oh, I would love
so
to
So you get
timber
the motion, hunting. But you don't get that constant mesmerizing motion because in a field, you get that. Because they're always moving.
Right, right, mm-hmm. right.
In the water.
No, Mojo's in a field setup with 4, 5, 6 of them looks very realistic to a flock of mallards landing.
And they give it up. In the water, I'd rather have water shaken. So.
Shaken, not stirred.
Shaking it up.
Shake and bake.
So hunted fields for a long time and just kind of was like, yeah, I've done this every day for so long. Let's go find something else to do.
When did you first get into layout boat hunting?
The first layout boat hunt I was ever on, coincidentally, was with Brian Klein.
Oh.
And
I don't think it's coincidental. You guys were best buddies and hunted and fished all the time together.
Yeah, true.
One of the first hunts I ever went on was with Brian Klein.
Some amazing hunts and some cool experiences with that guy. He's a great friend to have.
He's like a ghost now, though. I don't even ever know where he is or what he's doing. I just see pictures of his face, like close-ups with mushrooms. He's kind of like Sasquatch. It's a legend that you're not sure actually exists.
Not even kidding. Pretty close to 350 days he spent outside last year getting paid.
Yeah, that's
so
awesome.
That's pretty awesome. You talk about somebody that's making a living outdoors and really making a living.
That's great.
But we went layout hunting and for Old Squaw. And I was like, oh, I'm doing this all the time.
Okay.
Because back when I started doing it.
So talk about layout hunting for someone has no idea what it is.
So we're going to take a big old boat out there and we take a little boat with us and we put you in it and you lay down in it.
Like a UFO spaceship, like those tiny individual UFO ones that you see in the cartoons. That's what I think of them.
Layout Addictions makes a really nice boat too. UFO makes a boat. We're looking at...
it's actually called UFO?
Yeah, it's literally called UFO.
Look at me go.
See, Danielle?
I know things.
Banks.
You know something.
Banks is kind of the originator of the concept in the boats. they made a boat back in the day, and it's actually... It didn't really start here. It started, like, in Utah. They layout boat hunt for puddlers.
So explain
which is an amazing experience. I got to do that.
How the layout boat works. Is it attached to the main boat?
No, so it's anchored to the bottom, wherever that anchor, whatever depth that is. So if it's 200 feet down, it's 200 feet down. If it's 3 feet down, it's 3 feet down. Wonderful. And you lay in it like a layout blind in a field.
Okay.
Without doors.
And then the tender boat is the big, the deep V or the other boat that's with
you.
Or
the other boat that goes and picks up the birds, carries you to and from.
So when you drop someone off at the layout boat, they're out there by themselves.
Well, I run a two-man, so you're not out there by yourself. Some people want to do it by themselves. I have two single boats, but most people I've found want to hang out at least with somebody while they're out there.
Yeah.
Especially in Lake Michigan. It's pretty intimidating.
Yeah.
Getting into 100 and some feet of water in 2 or 3 foot waves to shoot.
Yeah, okay.
This
you're
is
not
convincing you.
That's what I'm saying. You're not. I hear that, and I think that does not.
It's heart pounding, man.
But there's
live
life
for the
jackets.
Adventure. You know?
I do. I have an adventuresome life.
But this is
very
like,
adventuresome life.
This is one of the.
But I've got two children and I'm 52, so I'm not out there trying to die.
And
doing
I paint
something.
That picture.
Violet can come with us.
60-70% of the days are pretty calm. And,
if it's
I mean,
anchored
very
to the
little.
Bottom and you got a 3 foot wave, that means that water's coming over the top of you.
No, we got a big bungee attached to that thing, so it rides the waves really well.
So it stretches.
Yep, stretches out, absorbs the shock.
Ooh, talk about the decoys, the decoy spread.
Yeah, how
that
do you
was
run decoys off of
that?
Off
that
of
looks
that.
Pretty cool.
You just pin them right to the front. I run some custom decoys that I had made by a guy on the East Coast, John Ketchum.
Have you ever done this, Danielle?
I have. That's the only reason why I keep talking
You've
about it.
You've done this.
With Keller, actually. And I, Bill, if Bill was here,
he has a great
You
want
to
hear
story.
An adventure story?
Yeah. Did he almost die? Because that's the only place I hear about this.
We decided we were going to go up north for Northern Opener and layout hunt one of the legal layout
What's the
up
water there. Temperature at this point?
Depends where you are.
Usually.
Cold.
At this point, it was like 60, 65 degrees because it was October.
Oh, so you're only
going to
die of hypothermia after 15 minutes,
right.
Not five.
In December, the water temperature is about 38.
Ooh.
It freezes sometimes. So what's the water temperature got to be to freeze?
32.
And that's people are like, oh, where's the life jackets? I'm like, hey, you worry about other things. Like staying warm and getting out of the water.
Yeah, if you fall
like,
in the water,
floating.
The life jacket is not the issue. You're
right.
going to die of hypothermia.
Right, you
way
need to get out.
So hypothermia scares me, probably more than drowning.
So the cool thing is the layout boats are super safe. They actually ride better than the big boat.
Have you ever heard our buddy Nico's story?
Yeah, it's... You
Everybody
know, you can never
story.
Overcome fear and common sense or stupidity and
well,
common
you can
sense.
Overcome fear,
if
I guess,
you
but...
do stupid stuff, you win stupid prizes.
So play stupid
I don't go out when it's 5 and 6 foot waves, and I have a kid's and a life, and I want to enjoy it as well. I'm not trying to get thrown around the ocean or the lake or anywhere and die.
And
so there's
you
a limit
like a
to the
smirk
sailing.
On your face. Would you ever try this layout boat hunting?
I just Googled one. I've never seen one before, and I was trying to understand how it works. So you're laying on your back in
Correct.
The lake?
Yep. So
yeah, I do.
And
this,
it,
I
like the
asleep.
Water level is right there with you.
I have a lot of people that fall asleep in the layout
yeah.
boat.
Oh, yeah,
it just rocks them to sleep.
And fun thing about me, I am terrified, absolutely terrified of water. If I can't touch the bottom... There's zero possibility.
So my determination is, can I safely get the tenor boat to the layout boat? If I can safely touch those two boats together without major impact or without crushing the layout boat with my tenor boat, we're going hunting. That happens in about 2 to 3 feet waves. Nothing insane. And if it is insane, they're not going to touch and you can't get in and out. That's the limiting factor is you have to be able to get in.
So how do you make sure you do it on a day where it's crystal calm?
Well, you have a really good relationship with your Lord. Ask him to
Lord.
Pick a day for you a year ahead.
I'm afraid
and then
God
give
has
you really, really good
weather.
Than
that.
Hey, it is.
How did I
We're
say it to a guy the other day?
Problems.
I'm not one of those people that
but, okay, but,
think their time is the only thing in the world.
You have somebody. There's more than, there's like 4 people you can have on
so
there.
So usually we take out 4 guys
so
and me.
It's, you hand your guns over safely like you're crossing.
Right.
Like they have, somebody holds the boat here, somebody holds the boat here. So it's like you're holding it there while you, one person at a time,
The last
there.
Thing I'm worried about is like the safe passing of firearms back
no,
and forth.
No, I'm talking about you passing back and forth. Like it's
because it's
all...
it's
I'm not even as afraid of what happens.
What are you afraid of?
I'm sure you've had people hypothermia.
But like
you
how
get
like
wet
falling
get
in when you get in there?
How many people have you taken who've gone in the drink?
0. I had a boat last year that got a lot of water in it. Like a lot of water in it. And we still pick them out and pick the boat
and
out.
Plus,
and we had a wave. The splash shield failed, and the wave went over, and it got very.
What's a splash shield?
Well, that's the thing behind you that keeps the waves
from
going
filling
in
your boat.
Correct. Yeah, and getting all over.
So
you
it
and
broke or bent down, or
it bent down, and they took a wave over the back, and it got wet. Totally, still very safe.
I'm literally shivering listening.
Very
to the story.
Cold. So they got wet. Got cold. I grabbed them, drove them to shore. With I carry a Mr. Heater. I have extra clothes. I have towels. So if somebody I'm prepared for like marine level preparation for the worst case scenario, I have a first aid kit. I have everything that you would have on a field hunt. Plus I have a whole load of clothes. Like, I have an entire Sitka
Hudson suit. I can just see myself freezing and wrapped in one of those stupid tinfoil blankets. No.
But the, okay, no. The one thing that
I'll put you right in front of the Mr. Heater and put a brand new Hudson suit on you, and you'll be gravy.
For the one thing that was terrifying me.
Sitka Hudson suit. I carry an extra one on the boat dry, along with towels and a gradient underlayer suit.
All right. Now.
The one thing that was terrifying me, that because I didn't want to go out there and not be able to communicate, is that he checks on the walkie-talkie like every 10 minutes.
There's only a couple of reasons. Are you shooting? Is there a bird down? Or what's wrong?
Yeah.
Because otherwise you're laying there looking for birds.
Well, that's layout boat hunting. When we come back, we're going to talk to Mike Keller about deep sea fishing Lake Michigan and his contest. We've got to get to your contest. You got to promo your business.
We'll be
right back on Raised in Wisco with Joel and Danielle. I think that's an interesting choice for
MTV.
I want my MTV for a radio show. That's an interesting choice. Mike Keller, Captain Mike
Money
Keller.
Money for nothing.
Captain of the Wild Blue Yonder. Mike Keller's on the show. You're listening to Raised in Wisco. I'm your host, Joel Clayfish, alongside Danielle Fairman, who is like, Danielle,
Danielle's done all this stuff. Where have you been?
You're popping now. Everybody's coming to Danielle to ask her to do all this women in the outdoors stuff, which I'm pretty jacked about because I feel like you're a pretty good representation of the fastest growing contingent of outdoor sportsmen, which is women age 18 to 35. And I think, you know, people are coming to you now, probably getting a little more notoriety because of the radio show and the TV show we used to do. And I think, and Danielle's going to be on a panel. I gotta promote this. It's not for quite a ways away, but the Wisconsin Waterfowl Hunters Expo is absolutely awesome.
I'm very pumped about this.
And the Fowl Life has a main booth there with jargon and banded clothing. I'll be there. I'm doing a cooking demonstration. We're going to have a field calling contest.
Ooh.
This is not going to be like the fancy schmance, you know, specific calling contests for ducks and geese. This is just going to be a field calling contest.
Oh, I'm going to get in there.
Sign up
goose
at
one.
The show. We're going to give away some jargon prizes. We're going to give away
Dave Nelson's not going to be there, is he?
Dave
is he
Nelson's going to judge. So he's not going
to
be in it.
He's not allowed to play.
Is that what you call it, playing a goose call?
I am calling it now.
Calling a goose call.
He can't play the game.
It's playing it.
I think if you're
like a flute.
If you're using it right, it's musical. No
goose,
doubt.
I'm better than I am with duck. But duck, I can feeder call, but nothing else.
You spend so much time in a vehicle during the day. You should be calling.
You should be calling.
I do.
You bring your call with you into the digger.
Into the excavator.
Excavator.
Or the haul truck or the dozer, yes.
Come on. Do you really?
Yep.
Get
sure
better
do.
At calling and then, remember, is listening to more live birds.
Yep,
that's all you need to do.
I used to sit right next to them in the pond and just listen while getting loaded with the excavator when I'm in the haul truck. And see, it wasn't me this time. It was not me this time.
It was. You just said getting loaded with dirt. Oh. While your truck's loaded with dirt.
Yes.
Okay. Just to be clear to Danielle's bosses, she's not drinking on the job. Mike Keller, we just had that segment about layout boat hunting for ducks, and I'm very intrigued by it. I very much would like to do it. Danielle's done it. I have a few dates left. I'm still a little afraid to do it, though. I'm still a little afraid to do it. What does something like that cost?
I charge $1,000 for two guys, $1,100 for three, and $1,200 for four.
Okay.
So,
well, that's pretty reasonable.
It's $1,600 per person out on the East Coast.
Oh man!
Like for a 3-day hunt. So
yeah, I believe that. So that is something that I'm now. You as a person trying to make a living in the outdoors, you've diversified and you started salmon trout fishing on the Big Lake, haven't you?
Yep, I had to have something to do during the summer. So hey,
Instagram. What's,
everybody's on Instagram right now.
What is the name of your what is the name of your outfit? You haven't promoted your outfit at all.
All of it. Fowl Dawgs LLC. Hashtag Fowl Dawgs. Yes, it's Dawgs, like they would say it down.
Like waterfowl. Fowl Dawgs.
If you go to my Facebook and Instagram, it's on there as well.
Yeah.
Yes, Danielle has been promoting some of that stuff. You have a giveaway coming up for Mother's
Day? I do. We're doing a Mother's Day giveaway. We're giving away.
Today is the last day you can sign
up for. Today is the last day you can, well, until I draw tomorrow sometime around 5.
Okay. What are you giving away?
A trip on Lake Michigan to Charterfish.
For 5 people.
I recently went to a higher level on that. I've been doing that for on and off for 5 years seriously, 10 to 15 years not so seriously. Used to do it out of my little boat, and now I got a big boat, and I'm taking 6 people a day.
It is a nice big boat. It's a very nice boat.
What kind of, tell me about your boat, and tell me what someone can expect if they go out with you to try to catch some
salmon. So I have a 36-foot Chris Craft. It's nice and stable, 13 feet wide, handles the waves really well. You got a lot of room on the back deck. Everybody can be out there. And be comfortable, not like some smaller boats where you got to be like over here or in here or inside.
How many rigs you running on that at a time?
Between 12 and 18.
Holy cow.
If I got 6 people, you get 3 lines a person. And if I got all 6, we're running. Like if we're in deep.
The more you're running, the more fish you're catching.
The more fish you catch, the more chaotic it gets. The better you got to drive.
Chaos is fun when you're fishing.
The cohos are just starting to run. Today we had an entire side go off, which was 6 lines on that side of the boat. We're fishing shallow on one side and a little bit deeper on the other side. And we ran over a bait pod on one side. And literally 6 of the 12 rods we were running today went off at one time. Boom, 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 boom.
Wow. So and you hit a school.
We hit a school of fish that was really feeding aggressively, and we boated 5 out of the 6 fish.
Spoons?
I ran about 50-50 mix right now of spoons.
Swim baits?
Nope. No swim baits here. I'm a traditionalist. I run Dodgers and flies. I have some custom-made products from Screamin' Drags Tackle Company. I also get some stuff from Chase and Tails, and I get some stuff from ITO Flies in Michigan City there.
The IT one's working really well ITO, when we were out.
Yep, that's right now they're banging Lakers with that flasher that they made. They came out with a new flasher this year that's a little bit custom-looking, not like the traditional stuff.
You ever get into brookies out there?
We don't.
Yeah, I mean, that's a tough fish to catch, isn't it?
They're in brooks.
Yeah.
So they're not really in Lake Michigan. We get brown trout, lake trout, coho salmon, steelhead salmon and or rainbow trout, and then what everybody's prize is, the kings. And they're just starting to come in.
The Chinook salmon.
Been getting a couple of Chinooks in the last 2 days, yeah.
Yeah, over there.
Over there in the Lake Michigan, we went out and got the Chinooks.
You know what I think's awesome is catching the salmon when they're spawning and making caviar out of the roe. Have you ever? I've cured the eggs, most of the guys use that now for just more bait. Yeah, no, I get it. I've done that too, but I've made caviar out of it, and it's pretty awesome.
Sushi'd a coho the other day on the boat.
Oh,
that was pretty awesome.
I mean, I'll try it.
You sushi'd a coho?
Straight up sushi'd it right up.
Well, it doesn't get much fresher than that. Fowl Dawgs. Mike Keller was our guest today. Book with him. I'm going to tell you one thing about this guy. Nobody's going to work harder to make sure you catch fish or kill ducks if you're with him.
And for us females out there, he takes the pictures and takes videos, and he pumps us up like nonstop. So that's
I love taking ladies out. It's a blast.
Females,
they have so much fun.
Well, of course you love. You're a single guy.
No, it's not about that at all. I think that's why girls like going with me. It's because I'm not like that gross creepy guy.
Yes, definitely not.
But no, I love it because their excitement
on that
is great.
Before.
their excitement level is so awesome because they, you know, a lot of them never done it, so it's like big kids.
I love it. Fastest growing group, Mike Keller. You're the greatest, Captain Mike Keller. This is Raised in Wisco. We'll see you next week. Danielle and Joel, we're out.